Let us sing our offering song.
So may I see the hands of those who are excited to receive the Word of God today.
Amen.
And what about the rest? So only three people? May I see the hands of those who are excited to receive the Word of God. Amen. Hallelujah. So if you have your Bibles, people of God, I would like to encourage you all. And let us all stand, turning our Bibles to Proverbs chapter 19. And we're going to read verse 21. Proverbs 19, verse 21. Hallelujah. In Proverbs 19, verse 21, it says here, many are the plans in the mind of a man, but it is the purpose of the Lord that will stand. Let us all bow our heads and let's pray. Father in heaven, we believe, Lord God, hallelujah, that there is a right time, there's a right place, where, Lord God, you had chosen to manifest your glory and your power. And Father God, we know that this is not our usual place. But Father God, like Moses, who said, Lord, if your glory will not go with us, do not move us from where we are. And Father, we know that though we are not in our usual place, we know that your holy presence is with us. And we know, Father, that in this place, Lord God, you manifest your glory and power. And Lord God, in this place, there's an open heaven. Father God, your Holy Spirit is already moving. Your Holy Spirit is touching people's heart, people's life. And we thank you, Father, that He is the one who is directing us, Lord God, into the right direction, giving us the right mind, clearing our mind, Lord God, and right heart, Father, for us to receive and understand your words. Father, we know that your words are effective and are alive. So we ask you now to make it alive in every life that is in this place. We thank you, Father God, and to you alone, we bring back all the glory, all the honor, all the thanksgiving and praise. This we ask and pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Let's go back to our foundation verse. Hallelujah. This afternoon. Proverbs 19, verse 21. So it says here, many are the plans in the mind of a man. And this is true. I do believe with all of my heart that though you are seated there on your chairs, I know that you have your plan.
Amen.
After you know, this worship service, I know that my neighbor is going to treat me in a Chinese restaurant. Now you are already planning, or maybe to Kentucky. Or, you know, Five Guys. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Yes. Hallelujah. Amen. So, I do believe that you have your own plan. Okay? And even, you know, a month before, a year before, you have already plans in your life, in your mind. But it says here that despite of there are many plans in the man's mind, it is the purpose of the Lord that what? That prevail. So what does this mean? This means that man proposes, but it is God who disposes. So all these thoughts, all of this plan that we have are just a proposal. You know what James said? For those of you who knows your Bible, for those of you who knows what James had written to the church, James said, don't say, next month, next week, next year, I'll be going to such and such place, and I'll doing, you know, my own business, making business, doing business. James said, you know, this is not possible. Because he knows that only man can propose, and God is the one who disposes. We can only plan. And James said, rather, you should say, if the Lord's will. Okay? That's the reason why it is important for us to know the will of God. My question is, do you know the will of God for you? Do you know? Do you know the will of God for your life? Do you know what awaits you for 2024 or next month? The Bible tells us that we should not be foolish, but we need to be wise and know the will of God. And why is that? It is because we are living in evil days. The time where we are living is perilous. The time we are living is evil. Okay? And for that due reason, we need to know the will of God. And Paul make it clear for us, for us not to live foolishly, but for us to be wise. And that's not new. Even Jesus Christ, our Lord, he said to his disciples, you know, be what? Gentle as a dove, but be wise as a serpent. Jesus himself had given this instruction to his disciples. And Paul just repeated and make it clear that in the days where we are living, it is evil. Evil time. Evil days. And we need to be very careful. So, admit it or not, we like to do things our way. Hello? Admit it or not, we want to do things our ways. But the sad thing, despite of we are doing our own thing, we use the Holy Spirit. You know, we say it's the Holy Spirit. No. Just be honest to yourself. Just be honest to yourself. And you need, you know, like the Bereans, when somebody says something to you, look into the Word of God. Does it match? Are what they're saying, people saying, is in line with the Word of God? You know, the Bereans, Paul said, the Bereans are honorable. It is because after they had heard me preach the Word, he said, they go home and study the Word of God. If indeed, those that I've told them is in the Word of God, in line in the Word of God. Hello? Are we okay? Amen. Are we okay here today? Amen. Let us be very careful. Amen? Hallelujah. So, what is our motto? Our motto is, it is my way or highway, and brush others out of the way. And we know the famous song. You see, I don't even mention the name Frank Sinatra here, and you know what I am talking here, because he is the one who popularized that song, I Did It My Way, My Way. And most of the time, church, admit it or not, we are doing our own way. It is not the way of God. It is not the will of God. Because supposed to be in every situation we find ourselves, ask ourselves this question. If Jesus is in this case, what do you think Jesus will do? What do you think Jesus will say? What do you think Jesus will act, or will he react? Amen. Hallelujah. So, I'll give you a very good example today of people who did it their own way. A good example is, there was a point in time in the book of Genesis where they are all together with one language. And they said to themselves, let us what? Build a tower. And what I'm talking here is the building of the Tower of Babel. They want to build a tower in order for them, what? To have their name. And most of the time, we do things because we want to have a name. Correct? It is for our name's sake. Hello? Listen, what's the use? You having a name and destroying people's life. You know, for me, I would rather give up and the name of Jesus be glorified. And the people of God be united and be intact. You know, I counsel many people. I talk to them many times on this subject. What's the use having your title? And most of the time, you know, people use their title. God is not a respecter of your title. Tell you honestly and frankly, God is not a respecter of your title, whether you are a bishop or a big shot. Amen? Whoever you are, God is not interested to your title. What he is interested is what you are doing. Is what you are doing the will of God? Did you ask God the question, God, if your son, Jesus Christ, my Lord, is in this situation, what is he going to do? Because when Jesus faces crisis in life, all that he did was, Father, forgive them, for they know not of what they are doing. He didn't judge them. He didn't condemn them. And even the Bible tells us there is no more condemnation who are in Christ. You know, the Tower of Babel is about man's determination to live sufficiently, determinedly, and arrogantly without God. And most of the time, we decide things in our life, admit it or not, it is without God. But we use the Holy Spirit. We sound so spiritual, but in reality, we are wrong in our doctrine. Because we don't know doctrine. We don't know the Word of God. We don't know the will of God. And by the way, what I would like to share to you is trusting God's plan even when He doesn't align with our plan. That's the title. Okay? Trusting God's plan. Whom are we going to trust? Our plan or God's plan? It says here, okay, that we are going to trust God in His plan when it doesn't align with our plan. Because most of the time, we want God to align with our plan. Okay? But here, okay, no. It's the other way around. It is us trusting God's plan even when it doesn't align with our plan. People think they are smart in themselves. But in reality, it is because of their arrogance. Okay? It is because of their pride. Because of holding to their title. People think they are smart in themselves, fine without God, and is saved in their own hands. Man thinks that with advanced technology, new industries, active collaboration, and concerted effort, nothing can stop them from reaching the top. Literally. However, God reminds us that His counsel will stand. His counsel will stand. It's not our counsel. It is not our will. It is not our plan. But it is His plan that will prevail. Relying on God guarantees our well-being. But excluding Him from our lives, it means failure. Excluding God means failure. Failure in every areas of our lives. As I said a while ago, we all have plans. There's large plans, such as, you know, going to college, buying our own houses, buying our own cars, pursuing our careers, having a family, getting a job. But also there's smaller plans, such as, you know, hanging with friends after the service at Kentucky. Or eat all you can. Okay? Or going shopping, you know, Monday. Or just simply making pasta for dinner. Those are small, you know, small plans. Okay? In our mind, most of us have some ideas for our future, whether it's 10 minutes or from now, 10 years from now. The simple truth is, we spend so much of our time designing our future. And that's true. We want to design our own future. We want to do it our way. Church, it's time for us, you know, to change our styles. It is not our way. Let us be honest with ourselves. Let us, you know, just be honest for a while with ourselves. How many plans that we had failed in the past? Come on. Just be honest to yourself today. How many of your plans had failed? You fell face downwards. But listen, still we could see there, despite of our foolishness, despite of our arrogance, despite of, you know, trying to push our own agenda, our own way, our own desire, God is still so gracious to us. She still calls us back. Bring us to our senses. Bring us back to our right mind. And telling to us, come on, my beloved, you know how much you had failed. Stop pushing your own agenda, your own way. And listen, people of God, I learned this hard way. Of course, I could say this to you because now I'm old. When I was young, I was, you know, so foolish enough, thinking that I can, you know, make God fit into my agenda, on my own way, on my own method. But you know what? I found out that not. It's impossible. I have many plans, but it's not the plan of God. I have many ways that I know because I think I'm smart. But listen, people of God, please. The Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, in verse 11, it says, these things are written, these things are recorded in order for them to be an example for us and to warn us not to do the same thing, the same foolishness. Listen. You might be a, you know, young born again. Or you might be 10 years born again. Or 20 years, 30 years. But the question is, what have you learned from all those failures and mistakes? Are you still arrogant? Or you are now softer, more kind, more gentle, more understanding, more forgiving? Hello. Come on, people of God. It's an honest question. What happened when our plans for ourselves don't align with God's plan? That's a question. What happened? Pastor, what happened if our plan doesn't align to God's plan? We all had experience, as I said a while ago, fail plat to our faces, you know, because we fail on our plans. But here again, most of the time, there's a greater reason why God allows us to fall. Why God allows us to fall. Can I tell you a secret? In the Bible, all of the great men of God, in whom he had called, had anointed, and had blessed, had fallen. Tell me one that haven't fallen. None. But they all learn from their mistakes. And you know, they became softer, kinder, more understanding, more forgiving. You know, if you look at Psalm 51 is written by King David. A year after he had fallen, a year after he had committed adultery, after he had committed murder, he said, God, correct me in order for me to correct those who had fallen as well. You see, now he learned from his mistake. And God allowed him, it is because for him to learn and for him to teach those in whom, who will encounter the same failures in life. May I see the hands of those, and I want you to raise your hand, those who are perfect. No mistakes. No error. You are always right. I thought it's the wives who are going to raise their hands. Because most of the time wives said, I am always right. And all the wives said, Amen, hallelujah. Thank God I'm a wife. Amen. You know, sometimes women claim that they are always right. Hallelujah. You know, somebody agree with me? A husband like me. Hallelujah. Listen, failed plans, I would like you to see this thing today. Failed plans actually save lives or resulted in something for a better than what is intended in first place. And this is true. Failed plans, most of the time, are a blessing in disguise. Because it saves life. It saved the life of the one who failed and those who are going to experience the same failure. And that's true. So today, I want us to look at the important reason in trusting God's plan. Okay? It says in Proverbs 19, verse 21, our foundation verse, many are the plans in a person's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that prevails. So the Bible directly tells us that no matter what our plans are, the Lord's plan is what will come to fruition. And this is scripture is so important because it is stating the fact, the reality, the truth. God's plan triumphs our own. And our life will follow the path that His plan has created. And this is true. People of God. If we will yield into the leading of the Holy Spirit, our life will just follow the leading of the Holy Spirit, God. And now we know. And now we are certain that it is the Holy Spirit who is guiding us. Sometimes God's plans are different than ours, and it is true. It's not sometimes, but most of the time, it's God's plan is different than our plan. But there is always a reason why. You know, God, you know, will have His plan, which is the right plan, for a reason. There's a reason. Do you know that? Because God is an omniscient God. He knows the past, He knows the present, and He knows the future. Do you believe that? Do you agree with me that He's an omniscient God? He knows the past. God knows our past. God knows our present. And God knows our future. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. So there's only two persons, by the way, who knows you. Who are those two persons who knows you? God and?
You.
It is you and God alone knows who really are you. No other person. Don't you know that I stopped saying, I understand you. I know you, your situation. I know you. Because the reality is, I don't know. I don't understand. I don't know the person personally. Okay? I don't know. You stop saying. Okay? And don't tell to the person, I feel what you feel. Because you don't. You don't. You don't know the person's struggle. And don't judge. Okay? Because you don't know anything, by the way. You know a small percentage of the life of the person. I stop saying, oh, I know. Oh, I feel. I tell the person, I don't know. But I want to help you. I sympathize with you. And I don't tell to the person, I don't agree with you. I don't say, I agree. No. I need to hear first the whole truth. And I agree. Especially in teaching people of God, when people quote scripture, when people say something that sounds spiritual, I don't. I need to look in the Bible if that is in accordance to the Word of God. And for that reason, we study doctrine. We study doctrine. What is the doctrine? Correct, Mabel. So if ever you find yourself worried or uncertain about your future, just look at the passage. Just look at this passage of Scripture today. Let's go to Jeremiah 29, verse 11. What does it say in Jeremiah 29, verse 11? God said, "For I know the plans that I have for you." You see, God had already a plan. So why will you push through? Why will you insist of your plan? If God had already planned for you. Amen. Everything that happens in our life, God knows. But His plan never changes. It says here, "For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord." Plans for what? Wholeness. You know, in other translations, it says not for calamity. Not for calamity. You know, most of the time, all we want is calamity for the person. Correct? We tell to the person, "Huwag kang madapa sana." So what do you really mean? Madapa siya o huwag siyang madapa? So here, it says here that even before the foundations of the world, the earth, God already have a plan. For God said He knows what He had planned for you and me. And you know what He had planned? He said, a plan for wholeness. Not for evil. And it says here, to give you future and a hope. So our future, people of God, is secured in God. Yes. Hallelujah. Whatever your past may be, and I don't know, and I don't want to know. I have many problems of my own. So if you don't have problem, wait for me at the end of the service. I'll give you some of my problem. No problem. Okay? It says here, for your wholeness. God doesn't want you to be broken. God doesn't want you, to suffer. God doesn't want you to be depressed, oppressed, discouraged. Come on, people of God. What is the word of God for? For the people to be discouraged? Or for the people to be encouraged? For the people to be hopeless? Or for them to see hope? I don't think so. God wants each one of us to be whole, healthy, strong. Amen? Going forward, advancing, going to the next level. Not to be depressed, not to be discouraged, not to be, to feel failure forever. There's two things, people of God. There is conviction and condemnation. There is conviction and there is condemnation. Condemnation will result to death. Can you repeat that word with me? Death. Yes. If you are condemning people, the result is death. They will die. But if you are an agent of God for conviction, it will give life. Judas was condemned. And because Judas was condemned, and you know what? You know what? It is from the devil. How? Because the devil will not, stop bugging you. He will keep on coming. He will keep on repeating. And he will keep on repeating your past. Your past. Your past. Your past. Why? Because he could not talk about your future. Correct? Look at in the Facebook. Facebook alone. All they could mention there is the past. Surprise. Hello? Come on. Had you seen any posts in Facebook where they declare future to the person? None. But when God speaks, he speaks of the future, of what he had made you to be. Hello. Amen. Does God tell you, you are condemned? No. You will not change. No. There will be no advancement. There will be no development. There will be no progress. For I know the plans that I have for you, saith the Lord. God didn't take away the difficult situation, people of God. And God will not. You remember Paul? Prayed unto the Lord because of the thorn in the flesh. He said, I prayed to the Lord 3 times, but the Lord said to me, Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. And you know what? The thorn in the flesh, it is not sickness, it's not a disease, but it is a person. So Paul had 2 persons that is pestering him. And Paul said, like you and me, Lord God, taman, pataman mo sila ng kidlat. Correct? God said, no, Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. There will be people in your life that will be pestering you. Okay? But God said, my grace will be sufficient for you. The second passage of Scripture that I would like us to see today is Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 to 6, where it says, trust in the Lord with all of your heart and do not lean on your own understanding, but in all of your ways acknowledge Him and He will make your path straight. Hallelujah. So the question is, Pastor, why? Why should I lean not on my own understanding? Because we know that the God that we serve is an omniscient God. The word omniscient means knowing everything. He knows everything. And because He is an omniscient God, God knows what is the best for us. God knows what is the best for us. Hello? Incidents of those who had experienced, they prayed, but there was no answer to their prayer. So there are 4 people here on my left, but on my right, you know, everybody's prayer was answered by God. Incredible! Wow! I want to know your secret, please. Because me, myself, there are so many prayer requests that God did not answer. Till now. I don't know why. Oh, yeah. No, ask them. Because me, you know, there are prayers that I don't know. Because God did not answer. For them, it's all answered prayer. So ask them a while ago. Okay, on my right side, please help those people on my left. Okay, give your secret to them. They need it. Okay? So now, you know, God knows what is the best for us. God knows what is the best for us. Amen. You know, the reason why you are in that situation for a while. I want you to know this truth. That when we are in a situation, it is not permanent. Okay? That is not your final destination. You know, it is like your stopover. Okay? It's like, for example, you want to go to the Philippines. Okay? So your stopover might be in Dubai, or maybe in Hong Kong, or in Singapore, or in Taipei. Okay? So those are stopover. That's not your destination. And where you are at right now are just stopover. And you know, when a plane stops into an airport, it is to refill, refueling. And you know what? When we are in this stopover of our life, we are refueling. Okay? Hallelujah. We are refueling. Praise God. Hallelujah. In a short time, we are going to fly again. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. God knows what is best for us. God knows what our future holds. You see, God knows. God is the only one who knows what lies ahead of us. Amen. So we need to trust Him. Amen. Then third thing is God knows more things than we can comprehend. And that's true. There are things in our life that we don't understand. Lord, why? Why these things had happened? Why, Lord? You know, even Paul, the apostle who wrote more than half of the New Testament, he said, the things that I want to do, I did not do. But what I did is the things that I hate to do. He don't understand. And he was so desperate and said, who will, you know, rescue me from this situation? Nobody, none. But he answered and said, praise God, Jesus. You know, church, in whatever your situation, you find yourself, there's only one way out. And he's the one who said, I am the way. I am your way out. I am the truth. I am the solution. I am the answer. And I am the life. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Then, the other scripture is Psalm 32, verse 8, where it says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. Who will instruct us? Who will teach us? God. Hallelujah. And he said, okay, and I will counsel you with what? With my loving eye on you. When God counsels us, he will counsel us with love. No condemnation. But with love. How do we love? We understand, we forgive, we forget, and we held people's hand, and we guide them and lead them and help them to maintain their rightful direction to righteousness. You remember Peter? When he was start drowning, what did Jesus said to him? You know, I love Filipino mothers. May I see the hands of the Filipina mothers here? Okay. So this is how Filipina mother correct their children. Okay. First, they tell their children, don't touch this, don't do that, or else. And we know children, the more we correct them, the more we help them do the right thing, the more they rebel. Correct? Correct? And when the child, you know, fell, the mom comes to the child, take out his slippers, okay, hit the child. I told you. Right? I told you. Then we hear that sweet sound. Pack, 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 pack. And that's how, you know, we grew up. But the Bible is different. When Peter had fallen, when Peter starts drowning, Jesus extends his hand, and all what he said to Peter, you men of little faith, why had you doubted? Correct? And when Peter denied the Lord, just imagine, didn't deny one, not twice, but three times. And it's already, you know, warned by Jesus. Jesus, you know, tell Peter, you know, Peter, you are like a Filipino. You are so humble. Masyado kang hambog. Because Peter said, everybody will run. But, you know, me, Peter, capital P-E-T-E-R, I will stay. Jesus tell Peter, Peter, that's not true. Even before the cock crows, you will deny me three times. And we know that it happened with a warning, but still, Jesus had restored Peter. And what did Jesus said? Peter, do you love me? That's all the question that he asked from Peter. Second, Peter, do you love me? Third, Peter, do you love me? And you know what had happened? Peter cried. Why? Because he was convicted. Bible tells us it is through the kindness of God that man repents. It's not too harsh, you know, or not threat. Okay? No. But it is through the kindness that man repents. Then let's go to Isaiah 55. Verse 8 to 9. It says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither your ways are my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts that your thoughts. So here, another reason why we need to surrender our lives, our plan to God, is because His thoughts and His ways are higher than our thoughts and ways. Most of the time, we know good things for us. And that's good. But the question is, is that God's best for you? Let us not forget, the enemy of best is good. And most of the time, because we are contented of what is good, according to our own judgment, that we are not able to receive and enjoy what is God's best. Correct? I see this many times. I see parents saying to their daughter, don't marry that guy. It is like you pick a stone and hit your head with that stone. And that's true. You are hard-headed. You are rebellious. You continue. You push through. But what had happened? Problem. From one problem to another problem, always problem. Life lesson. If there's one thing I've learned throughout my life, it is God's plan are always greater than my own plan. And I hope you learn the same today. And I hope you consider what you are listening here today. That God's plan are better than our own plan. Amen. Look at your children. There's a lot of children today. You know, they pursue a career. They go to classes in school that they don't like. And because they don't like, because it is what their parents want, they graduated. But despite of they graduated, they don't use it. Why? Because it's not what they want. No, it's like our neighbor. You know, when we are in the Philippines, we have a neighbor. And he wants his son to be a policeman. And the son said, no, I don't want to be a policeman. I want to be a beautician. And that's true. He did everything to hurt the son. Trying to, you know, pit his son to the mold that he wants. Then finally the son said, okay, dad, you win. I will go to the academy. But he said, but I want to be a policewoman. still a police. Okay? So here, church, as I'm saying a while ago, if there's one thing I've learned through my life, it's that God's plans are always greater than my own. And I've seen through failed relationship, changes in heart, disrupted plans, unexpected events, and so on and so forth. I believe some of you can identify with me, you know, with this experience in your life. Where opposite of what you had wanted occurred, but it ended up being better in the long run. You've heard Pastora said that our plan is just to stay 2 years here in France. To earn a little bit, you know, have a little bit of money, take my board exam, start a business. And during that time, you know, monkeys are thriving, so I would like to start a monkey business. So, but God had a different plan. God had spoken to me in a still small voice saying, He's going to use me here in France. And look, we've been here for more than 30 years now. God changes our plan. And God might be changing. God might be speaking to you today. God is speaking to you today. You have already planned everything. You even have, you know, the money, the amount of money that you want. You have already this idea of things. But listen, people of God, we had counseled a lot, not just one, not just two, not just three, not just 10 people. They want to go home, they want to go to the Philippines, so forth and so on. Look at them now. They want to go back. So why in the first place you want to go home, then want to come back? That means what you had planned failed. It didn't happen. But now it's hard for them to go back. We know a sister. Now she's in Taiwan, I think, or Hong Kong. Because she cannot go back here anymore. We have a brother who went home lately. Now he wants to come back. Listen, people of God, before you make a decision, church, it will have a great effect in your life. It will have. And some are irreversible. Now, there are things in my life that I regret. And it's irreversible. Irreversible. By the grace of God, hallelujah, God's love prevails. But still, suffer consequences. That's the reason why I'm urging you today, don't make any important decision in your life that one day in the future, you will regret it. Don't. It will not be easy. It will cost you everything. It will. You know, just lately, I had counseled somebody. I had reached to him in many times, in many ways, had helped him, but still he's hard-headed. When the thing had happened to him, I said, you cannot blame me. I didn't fail to counsel you. I didn't fail to call your attention. I didn't fail to tell you hard things, though I know you will not like it. And most of the time, people of God, if you think that it's easy to counsel people, no. Because we counsel them with our heart, not with our head. When Jesus counseled people, you know, use his head. Use his heart. And it will break your heart. That's the reason why, parents, I don't understand your situation, how your heart is broken. Because you had counseled, you talked to your children, you've said everything, you've done everything. It's still, they rebel. All that you can do is to cry. All that you can do is to pray. All that you can do is to hope and to have faith. Listen, people of God, most of the time, it is no longer trust. Because trust requires a proof. Trust requires proof. But God requires faith. Because it doesn't require proof. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, things that not seen. And that is my situation. That's my position. I have faith in you that what I have shared to you had entered your heart. That you will consider it. That you will meditate upon it. That you will ask God when you go home. Look yourself into the mirror of God. And submit your life to God's plan, despite of it is not in accordance to what you had planned. Can everybody's head be bowed low today? I do believe that the Holy Spirit would like to speak to people here today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. There's a person here today. You are in the valley of making decision. And you don't know really what to do. You don't know what to decide. You are in a place where your emotions, your mind are being cut into half. With all the head bowed low, I want all head bowed low, okay? I just want you to raise your hand today, if that's you. Is there anyone here? Yes, God bless you. I see that hand. Yes, God bless you. Yes, I see that hand. 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 I see those hands. I see those hands. For the Lord is telling to you, my people, saith the Lord, and this is a word from the Lord for you. For thus saith the Lord your God, my people, I know that you are in that valley, the valley of decision, saith the Lord, and you don't know, for you are being torn into half, saith the Lord. Your choice is, will I follow my emotions? Will I follow what my head is dictating? Or will I follow God? The Lord is telling to you today that you know and you know and you know my words. And you know my plans. And you know my will, saith the Lord your God. The Lord is telling to you today that the enemy wants to deceive you. He is the father of lies. He is projecting something that is not real and it is not true. For the Lord is telling to you today, I had already spoken. You had already heard my voice and you know my will, saith the Lord. If you will follow me and obey my voice, and if you will yield into the leading of my Holy Spirit, then you will see your path
prospering and succeeding, and you will receive and achieve what is best for you, saith the Lord. For I am the Lord your God, who is your light. I will carry you through. I know it is hard. I know that your emotion is one of the factors that's why it is hard for you. But the Lord said to you today, if you will follow my will, and if you will follow, hallelujah, where my Holy Spirit is directing you, He will lead you and guide you into light, into life, and in all of the blessing. The reason why the devil tries to deceive you and tries to confuse you is because he knows that where you are going is the land that I had promised you. Hallelujah. It is a land that is flowing with milk and honey, saith the Lord. It's the land of abundance, saith the Lord. Hallelujah. Follow not the voice of the enemy, nor the whisper of the evil one, but follow my leading, saith the Lord your God, and you will have life, and you will have blessing, saith the Lord your God. There are people here today, you feel condemned. It is because the enemy is condemning you of the things that you have done, of the decisions, actions, even the thoughts that you had made. The Lord wants to set you free today. May I see the hands of those, you know, you are being bugged by the enemy. Hallelujah. And you are being condemned. God bless you. I see that hand. I see that hand. Those hands, yes. God bless you. Hallelujah. I see those hands today. For saith the Lord unto you, my daughters, the enemy tries to condemn you because he wants you to end your pursuit to righteousness. And if he is able to take you out of the way, out of the path, you will be like the seed that have been planted into the pathways. The enemy comes and he eats it. But the Lord said to you, my daughters, I am bringing you into the fertile ground, and you are going to yield a fruit. Not of 30, not of 60, but 100-fold, saith the Lord your God. And the Lord is telling to you, my daughters, you are free from condemnation. There is no more condemnation who are in Christ. And you are. Your life is hidden in Christ. Your past is under the blood, saith the Lord. Hallelujah. I had set you free. Look, I had even cleansed you from all of your unrighteousness, saith the Lord your God. The enemy doesn't have a hold of you, saith the Lord. Hallelujah. For those who have been led by my Spirit, said the Lord, are free indeed. And that's who you are, my daughters, saith the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God, for your words. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There are people here today. The Lord is telling to you that you don't know what lies ahead of you. Some of you don't even know your future. Some of you, you don't know what will happen to you. And because of this, there's fear in you, saith the Lord. And the Lord wants to speak to you today. Hallelujah. He wants to clear your mind and give you a clear picture of what He had in store for you. He wants to give you a glimpse of the glory, hallelujah, that is ahead of you. With all heads bowed low, Can I see the hands of those whom God, hallelujah, had called and mentioned today? Is there anybody here today? You are honest, saying, yes, Pastor, I'm that person. I don't know. I don't know what's lies ahead of me. And I want to see a glimpse of my future. God bless you. God bless you. Yes, God bless you. 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 I see those hands. God bless you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God. Here is what the Lord is telling to you today. My people said, the Lord, it is because of the greatness, hallelujah, of what lies ahead of you, that the enemy tries, hallelujah, to put you in a situation where it is, you know, ambiguous to you. You cannot see because it is foggy. You cannot see because there's a hindrance. Why? It is because of the greatness, saith the Lord. You are called for greatness, saith the Lord your God. And God, hallelujah, wants to open your eyes, saith the Lord. For the word of God said, for the prince of this earth had tried to blind the minds of those who are unbelieving. That's the direction where the enemy wants to bring you, unbelief. But the Lord today had spoken to you. It is because of the greatness. Hallelujah. It is because of the greatness. Hallelujah. It is because of what God wants you to become that the enemy tries to put fog, hallelujah, into your path. Put boulders to cover your sight. Put hindrances. But the Lord today is telling to you, follow the leading of my Holy Spirit. Though you cannot see, I will lead you through my voice, saith the Lord. For you will hear a voice in your back saying, turn to the right, go straight, turn to the left, continue. And indeed, saith the Lord, I will be with you throughout the way, saith the Lord. And I will guide you, I will strengthen you, and I will be with you and for you, saith the Lord your God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah. Can we all stand today? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Here are the key points that I want to inculcate in your mind and in your hearts today. As we listen to this message, first point that I would like to inculcate in your hearts is God's plan is always greater than our plan. Number two, second point is the plan of for us might always align with our own plan. So that's normal. Okay? Don't make God to fit in to our own plan. It doesn't work. Because most of the time, God's plan is not always the same with our plan, and it will not align with our plan. Then the third point is the key to staying confident in God's plan is for us to trust Him. Trusting in Him will make us stay confident of His plan. Hallelujah. Let us repeat these words with me today. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your words. We thank you that through your words, you guide us into light, into life, and into blessing. Today, Father, I surrender my will to you. Father, like Jesus, my Lord. Not my will, but yours to be done. I will follow your plan. I will submit to your plan. Because I trust you. Because I believe in you. This I ask and pray. In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. God bless you. Amen. So